morning, everyone. You're very welcome this morning. In Paul's second letter to the Corinthians, as we have it in the New Testament, he writes this. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. For what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. So here we are. We've come into this place full of hopes and fears, a mixture of expectation, frustration, and concern. And what we see around us tends to challenge us, shape us, perhaps even dominate us. So it would be good for us right at this moment, before we do anything else, to pay heed to the psalm writer, who, like Paul, points us beyond ourselves, beyond our circumstance. And in Psalm 95, the psalm writer gives us this encouragement and invitation. Come, let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for He is our God. And we are the people of His pasture, the flock under His care. Bowing and kneeling can be physical actions. But when the psalm writer speaks of it, when the scriptures speak of it, it is more than just a physical action. It is an attitude of heart and mind and soul. So let's come and bow. Let's come and kneel. Let's pray. Father, today in this place, we bow and we kneel. We actively and deliberately take our eyes away from what we see, from what consumes us, and actively and deliberately we turn our eyes on You, our God, our Maker, our Redeemer, our Life Giver, our Restorer, our Hope Giver. Pour out Your Spirit upon us, that we might be filled with praise and rejoicing. Pour out Your Spirit, that we might encounter You now, in this moment, in this place. Come, Lord, transform this moment from a fleeting experience to a faith-shaping encounter. From an act of service to an experience of forgiveness and grace. Come, Holy Spirit, lead us, guide us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're going to sing together now. We're going to use two pieces drawn from the Psalms, one based on Psalm 103, and the other a contemporary version of Psalm 23. So let's stand as we sing Praise My Soul, and then The Lord's My Shepherd. And if you want to sit at any point, if you want to begin by sitting, that is fine. Let's bring our hearts, our souls, and our minds, and let's worship our God together. Let's worship. few things just to remind you about. There's three ways you can interact here this morning with what I'm going to remind you about in our announcements. You can pray, and I really ask you to pray for each of the things I'm going to highlight. You can participate, so come and be part of the things that I'm going to highlight. And you can pass on the word about the things that I'm going to highlight. So pray, participate, or pass on the word. So this afternoon, Messy Church, we're hosting it here in Stormont. We kick off for a new term with our partners in St. Malua's, 4 o'clock through to 6 o'clock. If you want to come and check it out, and stay for a little bit, stay for a lot. If you stay for a lot, you get free food. How's that? Come and join us this afternoon, or pray, or pass on the word to those who might be interested in doing so. Then we've got our Let's Learn. This complements our Let's Pray initiative. We've been encouraging you to pray and to seek prayer for yourself and for others. Let's Learn is an opportunity for us to gather, to share life, to support each other as we seek to be followers of Jesus, and to spend time listening to Jesus as we study the scriptures together. So we're going to create some connect groups, 68 people who meet a couple of times a month. And you'll get an email tomorrow morning if you're on email, which will let you sign up for that. I encourage you to do so. If you're not on email, then we have some hard copies in the vestibule, and you can tick the boxes and hand it to me, and then we'll let you know in a couple of weeks' time when these groups will be starting. So that's the Let's Learn Connect groups. YF kicks off again. We've had lots happening this month already. Jam's really back in swing again. Messy Church is kicking off. Youth Club started on Friday evening, and 17 were there, I think, so that was a great start. And so YF starts this Friday. So again, pray. And well, you might not think you're YF age, but you know, they'll not turn anybody away. So if you want to check it out, come and join them. I think there's some messy games as well on Friday. But pass on that word, please, for the YF. What's coming next? Oh, Sunday afternoon service. So that's on the last Sunday of the month, 3 o'clock to 4 o'clock. Again, pass that word on and come and join us for that. And then we have a big focus coming up now. The first Sunday in October is going to be our Connect Sunday. So we've got our Connect groups for getting to know each other better in kind of smaller gatherings. But we have a big church family. We have over 500 people in our big church family. And this morning we have 66 of them here. So we're missing a few, okay? We're missing a few. And we'd love to have more. So we're going to target the first Sunday in October and say, that's our big church connect. And this is where we need each other. I need you to pray for that service. I need you to participate, be there, put it in your diary, ring fence it. But I need you to pass the word on. So this morning you were given a little card to pass on to somebody that you know is part of our big church family and you haven't seen them for a while. Give them that invitation and say, come with me. Don't say come to church. Say come with me. Because it's about family and family gathering together. That's the first Sunday in October. 1st of October, 11 o'clock. As I said last week, we'll have coffee on the way in and coffee on the way out. And you might have coffee in the middle. Who knows? You'll be well caffeinated. But we want to be well connected to God and to one another. First Sunday in October. We have tea and coffee every Sunday after church. And there's a little donation bowl. And you might have noticed it, or you might not. And you might wonder, where does that money go? Well, it's going in two directions. So on the second and fourth Sundays, it goes to PW to support mission in Ireland and overseas. And on the first and third Sundays, it goes to Storehouse to support that work across our city. All you need to know is it's going to do good things, and it's a great opportunity just to throw a little bit of money in each week and support PW and support Storehouse. Which leads me on very nicely to the last thing, which is giving. Giving is a great opportunity for us to be a church family and to invest in our church family now and for the future. So I want you to see giving as part of your worship, and I want you to go away and think about how you can give more to your church family. Because the reality is, as you have faced challenges, so we face challenges too to meet our bills. And we have pared everything back as much as we can do. We need an increase. And so I'm appealing to you and to those who are watching online, please consider how you can give to your church family. It's a wonderful opportunity to show how much your church family means to you, to show how much God means to you. So I lay that request before you. I'm going to invite Brian to lead us. No, not Brian, Frona. So Brian panicked there a moment. Brian's doing the reading. Frona's doing the prayer. Thanks, Frona.
Let us pray. Father, we come to you at this time to pray for others and not ourselves. We thank you that we have homes to live in, a roof over our heads providing security, knowing we have somewhere to protect us from the elements. We pray for those suffering from the effects of the earthquake in Morocco. We ask for comfort for the relatives of those who have died, hope for the families of those who are waiting for news of loved ones, strength for the emergency services carrying out the search and rescue, wisdom and endurance for the medical staff caring for the injured. We thank you for the various aid organisations providing emergency shelters, food and clothing. Help us to be generous in our giving to such groups. We thank you for health in mind and body. We pray for those battling mental illness. Often this is not visible and is being hidden even from friends and family. Give them strength to make themselves vulnerable to ask for help. Let them know they are valued, loved, and wanted. Surround them with a community that is loving and understanding. Put people in their paths that can provide and help with advice. We pray for those suffering from illness of body. We ask that if it be your will, you will bring healing to this situation. Be with them, comfort them, and surround them with your peace. Be with their friends and families as they watch loved ones and care for them. Provide them with love and a sense of hope, knowing that you are always with them, even in the darkest moments. In the silence, we name those who we know need your comfort and peace at this time, and we lift them to you. We thank you that we live in a society that values justice. We pray that your will be done on earth and that all will do justice, love mercy, and walk humbly with you. Help the world differentiate between what is right and what is wrong. Bring peace and hope to those who suffer injustice, the marginalized. We pray for a world of compassion. We thank you for the food we have, so readily available in this part of the world. We give thanks for the farmers and fishermen who provide the food. We pray for those parts of the world suffering from extremes of weather, drought and flooding, that have destroyed crops, leading to food shortages and, at worst, famine. We cannot understand what true hunger is. The climate crisis is with us now and needs urgent and bold decisions to be made by governments to reduce and mitigate the damage. We have done much damage to the earth and we are sorry for that. Give leaders vision to see past greed. Help the people of the world to live sustainably so there is a secure future for our children. We thank you for all the members of our church family, for those who volunteer with various organisations week by week, and for those in leadership roles. We thank you for Albin as he pastors, teaches, and leads us week by week. Grant him wisdom and insight and the knowledge of your presence with him day by day. We ask all these things in the name of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
We're going to stand and worship again as we sing together, My Hope Is Built.
Thank you. The reading is taken from Mark chapter 4, reading verses 1 to 20. Again, Jesus began to teach by the lake. The crowd that gathered around him was so large that he got into a boat and sat in it out on the lake, while all the people were along the shore at the water's edge. He taught them many things by parables, and in his teaching said, "Listen, a farmer went out to sow his seed. As he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path, and the birds came and ate it up. Some fell on rocky places where it did not have much soil. It sprang up quickly because the soil was shallow. But when the sun came up, the plants were scorched and they withered because they had no root. Other seed fell among thorns, which grew up and choked the plants so that they did not bear grain. Still other seed fell on good soil. It came up, grew, and produced a crop, some multiplying 30, some 60, some 100 times." Then Jesus said, "Whoever has ears to hear, let him hear." When he was alone, the 12 and the others around him asked him about the parables. He told them, "The secret of the kingdom of God has been given to you, but to those on the outside, everything is said in parables, so that they may be ever seeing but never perceiving, and ever hearing but never understanding. Otherwise, they might turn and be forgiven." Then Jesus said to them, "Don't you understand this parable? How then will you understand any parable? The farmer sows the word. Some people are like seed along the path where the word is sown. As soon as they hear it, Satan comes and takes away the word that was sown in them. Others are like the seed sown on rocky places, hear the word and at once receive it with joy. But since they have no root, they last only a short time. When trouble or persecution comes because of the word, they quickly fall away. Still others, like seed sown among thorns, hear the word. But the worries of this life, the deceitfulness of wealth, and the desires of other things come in and choke the word, making it unfruitful. Others, like seed sown on good soil, hear the word, accept it, and produce a crop, some 30, some 60, some 100 times what was sown."
Thanks, Brian. I've been thinking all week, what's the difference between hearing and listening? The difference between hearing and listening. I want you to stand, please. I want you to put your right hand in the air. I want you to wave at me. Okay, you can take your seats. You can hear easily, without effort, without focus. But you listen when you respond. One definition of hearing and listening is this: hearing is the process, function, or power of perceiving sound. Listening is paying attention to a message in order to hear, understand, and respond. Hearing is passive. You don't have to do anything. No effort. It's involuntary. Listening is active, requires effort. Hearing, as another definition puts it, is a form of sensory input. Listening is a way to form connections with other people. The interesting thing about hearing and listening is this: you can hear lots of things all at once. And this is the moment when an ambulance is meant to go down the Upper Newton Arch Road, because it normally does at this point in the morning. But we can sit here, you can hear my voice, we can hear the ambulance if it happens to be passing. If you're in your home, you can hear a dog bark outside, or the TV, or somebody chatting. You can hear lots of things at one time. But you could only listen to one thing at a time. You can hear lots of things at one time, but you can only listen to one thing at a time. So a few moments ago, we heard the passage read to us from Mark chapter 4. And Brian read that to us. For the next few minutes, together, we're going to listen to that passage. To listen to this word from God. Now, as you heard it, it may have sounded very, very familiar. And there's always a danger with such a passage, and a huge challenge with such a passage. The danger is where you're sitting, you think, I've heard this before. I know how this one goes. I know what this means. And from my position, the challenge is, how do I get my congregation to listen and not just hear? At first glance, this seems to be a story or a parable that Jesus tells about seed and soil, about the Word of God and fruitfulness. But in reality, Jesus is using this story, using this parable, to tell us something about himself and something about how we are to respond to him. Jesus bookends the story with two quite striking statements. So in verse 3, he says, listen. And then in verse 9, he says, whoever has ears to hear, let them hear. It's as if Jesus is saying, on the one hand, pay attention. And on the other hand, listen up. There's an urgency in Jesus' words. There's an intensity in Jesus' words. What Mark presents here, by way of this story, is another Markan sandwich. We've encountered this literary structure before, where he starts one story, inserts another, and then goes back to the first story. And so here we have in verses 1 to 9, or especially verses 3 to 9, the story told. And then in verses 14 to 20, we have the story explained. And in between we have the place and the power and the purpose of parable. Not just this parable. Got the timing wrong there, folks. Not just this parable, but any parable. What we have as we read and listen to this story is what I would want to describe as an enacted parable. In other words, what Jesus is illustrating through the story, he demonstrates through his engagement with those who are hearing and listening to the story. What he illustrates in the story, he demonstrates through his engagement. Three out of the four Gospels record this story. And this story has three times as much failure as it does fruitfulness. And the fruitfulness, when it comes, exceeds the experience and expectation. For those who would have been listening, they would have instantly connected to what Jesus was saying, because they were very much an agricultural community. And so sowing and fruitfulness and reaping and crops, that was part of their everyday experience. And so when Jesus gets to the part of the story where the seed produces 30, 60, 100 fold, there would have been gasps all throughout the crowd, because that's way beyond what anyone would have experienced or expected. So the fruitfulness is off the scale, but the focus is on listening. So we've got the context here of Jesus, again, teaching by the lake. Crowds, as we've come to expect now, are growing with every story that Mark tells us. So the crowd now is so huge that Jesus has to get into a boat and move a little way off the shore just to be comfortable enough to teach. So you can imagine the beach and the sand dunes and all behind it as it raises up into the hills, packed with people. It's a natural amphitheater, full of people listening, hearing what Jesus is saying. But it's a selected story. Mark tells us that Jesus taught many stories, many parables. So he tells us this one. Why? Because the interesting feature is that Mark 4 is one of only two occasions in Mark's gospel where we have any kind of extended teaching recorded of Jesus' teaching. Mark doesn't major on the teaching. So why does he choose this particular story? Why is this one the one that he grabs from the oral tradition that he's been hearing from Peter and others? Why does he grab this one and commit it to paper? Well, verse 13 tells us, because Jesus, when he's with the 12, we've met them already, they were the ones chosen for a particular purpose, and the others around him that we read about here in verses 11 and 12, they are the wider group of disciples who have gone beyond hearing to listening. He says to that assembled group, because they've come to him and when they've got him on their own and they've said, what does this mean? What's that story mean, Jesus? Or to quote one of the members of my family, Jesus, what's the get it bit? I don't get the get it bit. What is it? And Jesus said, don't you understand this parable? How then will you understand any parable? And what we have then in verses 10 through 12 is the meat in the sandwich. This is the key to understanding why Jesus uses parables. The key to understanding how we are to view parables. Now, when this passage on the sower and the seed and the soils is unpacked by preachers, and I've done this too, it is easy to focus on what the seed represents. It's easy to focus on the different soils. It's easy to try and explore what that means in our context. And this bit in the middle tends to get glossed over or kind of ignored slightly. So this morning we're going to begin with the meat in the sandwich. Confession. When it comes to sandwiches, that's the bit I'm most interested in. The bit in the middle. So let's come and let's have a look at the bit in the middle. It's the most challenging bit. And what Jesus does here is that he quotes from Isaiah chapter 6. And there are six times in the New Testament that this passage from Isaiah 6 is referred to and quoted from. In every occasion, on every occasion when Isaiah 6 is quoted, it is with regard to and with reference to hardness of heart. Hardness of heart and unbelief. So verse 12, this is what it says. This is the quote from Isaiah 6. So that they may be ever seeing but never perceiving, and ever hearing but never understanding. Otherwise they might turn and be forgiven. This is the meat in the sandwich, folks. Now, Isaiah, in Isaiah, the background is that Israel, the people of God, were stubborn. They refused to listen to God's word. And so, in a similar manner that we read of in Daniel 12 and in Ezekiel 12, God sends his prophet to speak to the hardness of the heart, to reveal to the people themselves the distance that now exists between them and God. So there's a sense here in verses 11 and 12 in this parable as Jesus sets this passage up that parables confirm the state of people's hearts. So in other words, those who are with Jesus, who are in relationship with Jesus, they're going to be given the understanding. Those who are not with Jesus, Jesus describes as those on the outside, well, they're going to be confirmed in their unbelief. In verse 11, he does something really quite interesting. And Mark records it in the Greek in an interesting way. He says, to you, referring to the 12 and those around him, will be given the mystery of the kingdom. And then he said, to those on the outside, they'll be left in their unbelief. Where the to you and the to those occur in the Greek is at the beginning of each clause. And why is that important as your faces glaze over? Albin, why do you bother with this grammatical nonsense? There's a reason for it. The reason is this, that placing it at the beginning of the clause puts emphasis on the to you and the to those. In other words, Jesus is making a very significant contrast here. He's accentuating the differences between those who are in relationship with him and those who are not. But when you read this verse, and the fact that Jesus inserts it here in answer to a question from his apostles and disciples, is it not the case that Jesus is telling people parables to keep them out? Is that not what that's saying? Is Jesus telling parables to keep people out? What is true is this. Jesus precipitates crisis. He does it in person when he meets people, and he does it in parable when he teaches people. Jesus precipitates crisis. He divides people. There are those who will respond and move into relationship and will see that fellowship with Jesus and obedience to the will of God is the most important thing. It takes precedence. They hear, says Jesus. They believe. They bear fruit. Mark 4:20. That's what faith is. Hearing, believing, bearing fruit. Those on the outside, the vast crowd, oh, they hear, but it's a kind of in through one ear and out through the other kind of hearing. It's not held on to. It's that kind of passive hearing. I have a lovely friend who has a great way of defining or redefining nagging. She says, nagging isn't nagging if you weren't listening the first time. There's a difference between hearing and listening. And Jesus sets this up. And Mark presents this tension between God's plan and purpose and our response and reaction to it. For Isaiah, he was sent to preach to a group of people, and he was told before he went there, they're not going to listen. Their hearts are hard. But he was sent nonetheless. And when Mark committed this gospel narrative to paper, some 30, 40 years after the events, taking what was an oral tradition and making it a written one. It was at a time when there was a real tug of war going on for Mark and for the early church. A tug of war between what they understood the purposes of God to be and what they could see were the facts of history unfolding before them. Jesus precipitates crisis in person and in parable. So let's look at the parable then, just briefly. We have this story set up of a farmer, and he has this ground, and as Jesus describes the ground, it's pretty unpromising. We've got a path, we've got rocky ground, we've got weed-strewn ground. It's not great. It's not exactly the ground that you would choose. And yet, the farmer scatters. In verses 14 through to 20, as Jesus explains the story, he uses the word logos, which is the Greek for word. He uses it 8 times in that short time. In other words, God's word's available to everyone. There is a generosity here that is extraordinary. It's extravagant. It seems like a waste. Why would you scatter your seed on a path and rocky ground and weedy ground? Why would you do that? Because God is a God of generosity. Now, if you need air conditioning this morning, we have that built into our sanctuary. There are windows, so we can open them. So if you get a bit stuffy, put your hand up. We'll open some windows for you. But what's also interesting is that he uses the word hearing 4 times as he speaks about the response of the soil to the seed. And he likens it to the hearing of people to the word of God. So you're going to come with me again. I'm going to do a little bit of grammar. Okay, it's really important. It's make a lot of sense. Just hang in there with me. Okay, so the first 3 times that Jesus uses the word hear, as he explains the reaction to the word of God, it's in the aorist tense. Never worry too much about the fancy word or how it's spelled. Simply know this, that in that tense it refers to something that's quite perfunctory, that happens in a moment. It's the in through one ear, out through the other kind of listening. Superficial. Okay? That happens 3 times. But in verse 20, the tense he uses for the word hear changes from the aorist to the present. In other words, it's continuing hearing. Not just hearing and then your attention was off on something else shining. It's hearing and going on hearing and going on hearing. It's really important to grasp that little detail. Because when we put together the frequency of the word hear with the introduction and conclusion, listen up, pay attention. What we have here is the core of Jesus' message. Are you people who hear, or are you people who heed? There's a difference. Are you people who hear, or are you people who heed? Engagement and receptivity are vital. It's the word that has the power to produce the fruit. Because parables do not produce faith. They invite engagement. Parables do not produce faith. They invite engagement with the one who does. The word made flesh, Jesus. Okay, so wrapping this up, where do we go from here with this story? I've got 4 things I want you to take away with you this morning. The first is this, that listening is persistent. Listening only counts if we keep listening. It's noteworthy that everybody heard Jesus that day, the 12, those who were around him, and those who were scattered across the beach and the hills. They all heard him, but it was the 12 and those around him who listened, because they kept on listening. Listening only counts if we keep listening. Listening is active. It has to be. He says to you, pointing to the 12 and to the others, indicating that it's in relationship with him. As we are serious about that relationship, as we are committed to that relationship, as we are persistent about that relationship, that our listening becomes key. So I want to really challenge you this morning. We can come here, and it's good to be here week by week. Brilliant to be here week by week. And do bring others with you. It'd be great to have more of our church family here. But we also need to gather in smaller groups to be more intentional. Because I'm conscious that this is a one-way kind of traffic. And in the smaller groups, there's a chance for it to be two-way. A chance for us to sit down and read and think and talk and share and support, because we're in this together. Listening only counts if we keep listening. Listening must be active. Listening leads to understanding. We're not going to make sense of Jesus and what he's asking of us unless we commit to listening. And when we do, Jesus says, understanding will come, because he will give us that understanding. Here's the wonder of this. It's not about your intellectual or academic ability. It's not about your experience or how widely read you are. It is that you sit at the feet of Jesus and receive the gift he gives, because he gives the understanding. And it's his word that produces the fruit, because listening leads to fruitfulness, because God's word produces fruit. The outstanding feature of the story is that when the word was heard and believed and accepted, that it produced a fruit. Produced a crop that exceeded every expectation, all experience. That's what God wants to do in you and in me. Jesus called the 12. He called the disciples to be around him, because it's in community that we learn how to listen and we can encourage one another to listen. It's in community that we gain understanding. It's in community that fruit can be developed and revealed and enjoyed. Let's pray. Father, as we have gathered, you are here. And as we have paid attention, as we have listened, not only with our ears, but with our minds and with our hearts and with our souls, so you have been speaking to us. Help us now to respond. Hearing, may we believe. Believing, may we accept. Accepting, may we see fruit, your fruit in our lives. May we encourage one another, support one another, share with one another. May we do that as we gather week by week, in times like this. And may we commit to gathering at other times, in smaller groups, to invest in each other, to receive from you, to produce fruit that can be enjoyed not just by us, but by those around us, to your glory, to your honor, to your praise. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to, what are we going to do now? I have this worked out. What's up next? Oh yes, right. Let's take a moment. As part of our response, we're going to make our commitment, as we've been doing week by week, reminding one another of who it is we're called to love, how we're to do that. And then we're going to say the family prayer together. Well, maybe just let you sit for this week, because then we're going to stand and sing as we prepare to come to the table. So let's make this commitment together now. You keep your seats this week. Let's do this. Love. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. Love your neighbor as yourself. And let's pray this family prayer together. Our Father. Our Father in heaven, may your name be kept holy. May your kingdom come soon. May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today the food we need, and forgive us our sins as we have forgiven those who sin against us. And don't let us yield to temptation, but rescue us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We're going to sing together. As we do that, if you're sitting on the edges, could you move into the center just to make it a little easier for the folk who'll be distributing the elements? Let's use the words of this song as we prepare ourselves to come as a church family, as part of God's family, around the table of our Lord Jesus Christ, to receive the bread and wine that speaks to us of his gift, of his investment, of his love, and of his grace. So let's stand and sing, Behold the Lamb.
Thank you.
Please take your seats. Let's hear again how this meal came to be as Paul writes about it to the church in Corinth. Let me go over with you again exactly what goes on in the Lord's Supper and why it is so centrally important. I received my instructions from the Master himself and passed them on to you. The Master Jesus, on the night of his betrayal, took bread. Having given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, broken for you. Do this to remember me." After supper, he did the same thing with the cup. "This cup is my blood, my new covenant with you. Each time you drink this cup, remember me." What you must solemnly realize is that every time you eat this bread and every time you drink this cup, you reenact in your words and actions the death of the Master. You will be drawn back to this meal again and again until the Master returns. You must never let familiarity breed contempt. Anyone who eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Master irreverently is like part of the crowd that jeered and spit on him at his death. Is that the kind of remembrance you want to be part of? Examine your motives. Test your heart. Come to this meal in holy awe. This is the table of our Lord Jesus Christ. And in his name, I invite all those who know and love him to come and receive what he has given for us. We follow his pattern and his example. On the night he was betrayed, he took bread and he gave thanks. Let's pray and give thanks now together. Let's pray. Lord God, our Father, we bless and thank you today for your incredible generosity toward us. That while we were yet sinners, while we were condemned by our sin, you loved us and sent your Son Jesus into this world to pay the price we could not pay, to open up the way for us to know forgiveness, to experience fellowship with you, and to have promise of future with you. Lord Jesus, we come and thank you for your sacrifice in our place on our behalf. And we thank you for your resurrection, declaring that the price is paid, that freedom is now offered to all who will hear and believe and accept and respond. As we come to this table, we ask, Father God, we ask, Lord Jesus, that you would send your Holy Spirit, that this bread and wine might be set apart from all its normal uses to this very special use. That as we share this bread and share this wine, our faith might be reinvigorated. Our relationship with you might be deepened. Our connection with each other might be made stronger. Come, Lord Jesus, meet us in this meal. May we know your blessing, that we in turn might be a blessing to others. We offer this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Having given thanks, he took the bread and broke it and said, "This is my body which is broken for you. Do this to remember me." In a similar manner, after supper, he took the cup and said, "This is the new covenant sealed in my blood. Do this to remember me." These are the things of God prepared for the people of God. As you receive the bread and then subsequently the wine, I would invite you to pause, pray, wait, and when all have been served, we will share the bread and then the wine together in our unity in Christ and in our fellowship as a church family. Let's receive what God has given us in Christ. Take, eat, the body of Christ broken for us. Blood of Christ poured out for our forgiveness. Do this in remembrance of him. Who is like the Lord our God? Strong to save, faithful in love. My debt is paid and the victory won. The Lord is my salvation. Let's stand as we worship God together.
Thank you.
may the amazing grace of the Master Jesus Christ and the extravagant love of God the Father and the intimate friendship and fellowship of God the Holy Spirit be with each one of you, now and always. Amen.